Okay. Okay, thank you, and welcome to the 20th meeting of Session 6 of the Equalities, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee. We have no apologies for this afternoon's meeting. Our first agenda item is to continue taking evidence on the Gender Recognition Reform Scotland Bill, and it gives me great pleasure to welcome to the meeting Senator Regina Doherty, Leader of the Irish Senate. I refer members to paper one of their papers, and can I invite Senator Doherty to make a short opening statement, please?
Thank you, Joe. Thank you, Chair. And thank you to the members for inviting me here today. And before, I suppose, at the outset, I just want to wish you every success with the passage of the current legislation that's before you. We are a number of years ahead of you, not that many, but a number of years ahead of you in Ireland. In 2014, the Gender Recognition Bill was published. We started its journey from through both houses, the debate, obviously, second stage, committee stage, report stage, seeing it amended through finally being signed into law by our president in the 22nd of July 2015. Arising from that bill being enacted and being on the statute books for a number of years, and obviously the bill was a change in law to recognise the change of gender of a person and to provide forensic gender recognition certificates that were legally binding, and to amend the Irish Nationality and Citizenships Acts that were on our statute books from 1956, Civil Registration Act that was there since 2004, and the Passport Acts and the Adoption Acts, all to reflect the now new law that allowed people obviously to change and to be recognised as the gender that they presented in. That act was going well for a number of years, and we had reports and reviews at the end of every year of the amount of people that actually engaged with the act. So when I became Minister for Social Protection in 2017, I put together a small review group, because one of the criticisms that would have been made of the act in 2015 is that it didn't do anything for people who were non-binary, and it didn't do anything to recognise that people under the age of 18 obviously, you don't just wake up at 18 and 2 weeks and decide. You know, some of these journeys start much earlier for some of our citizens. And so as to have a look at the confines of the legislation, we put together a review group which encompassed all of the NGOs and the advocacy bodies that obviously would represent the people that we were trying to enact the legislation to the betterment for, but also all of the people that would have had genuine concerns, particularly when we were talking about 16 and 17-year-olds. And if we wanted to extend the conversation further to under 16-year-olds, well, then an awful lot more people with an awful lot more concerns reared their hand to be heard. So I established that review group in 2018. The body of the group was incredibly professional. Now, they did have a really robust debate, and the review lasted a lot longer than I expected it to. But by the end of that year, the review group came together with a comprehensive review and recommendations for the Act. And one of the main findings of the review group was that the legislation as it existed and enacted around 16 and 17-year-olds was far too onerous, that the people that we were meeting that were trying to navigate through that piece of legislation as enacted, who were in the 16 and 17-year age group, literally found it far, far too cumbersome. So we proposed a group of measures to reform the process, reflecting in the legal recognition of a person's gender is distinct from any of the medical interventions that may or may not be available in Ireland or in any of our neighbouring countries. And what we wanted to do was to absolutely just simply find a very clear but simple path for children between the ages of 16 and 17 by introducing an arrangement for self-declaration. The parental consent by both parents, the support mechanisms that were to be introduced to support the parents supporting their children in these decisions, we felt was absolutely hugely important, and they were to be established. But also, very importantly, that a simple, you know, revocation process, should anybody find that they had made a mistake or changed their mind or were still navigating the journey of, you know, their sexual liberation, that they could change the process literally by family mediation, coming together, changing their mind, and as simple as it was changed in law through the certificate of recognition, it could be changed back again if the people so wished. So we put together those reviews, the recommendations, and I put forward at the time, it was towards the end of 2019, put forward those recommendations to the OPLA, which is our parliamentary drafting people, to come back to me with legislation to enact those recommendations from this review. But very unfortunately, from my perspective, and maybe for some of the people that I was trying to advocate for, I lost my seat in the general election of January 2020. And the review has sat on a desk since then, unfortunately. There is no sight of it being revived so far. But I think, to be fair, the enactment of the Act in 2015 for 18 years and older is working incredibly well. It's working seamlessly. It was working very unassumedly until very, very recently. We never had any of the kind of debates, divisive debates, that we would have seen both in the United Kingdom, both in America and in Canada. We didn't have those types of divisive debates in Ireland during the 2015 enactment or during the review of 2019. We are, for some reason, not driven by any changes or proposed changes in legislation, we're experiencing that divisive debate as starting now. And there's a very small but growing campaign looking and seeking for us to repeal the Gender Recognition Act of 2015. So I fear we might have a summer of discontent ahead of us. But I think if we act with the dignity that we've acted with up to date and recognise that every human being, regardless of their gender, deserves to be treated with respect, compassion and humanity, I think we'll hold on to the values that we espoused in the legislation of 2015.
Right. Thanks very much, Regina. So we're now going to move to questions, starting with Karen Adam, please.
Thank you, Convener, and welcome, Regina, to the committee. It's lovely to see you here today. Thank you for your opening statement and for really helping us understand the path that the bill had went through. I would just like to take it back a bit to the very beginning of that and ask, what was the context of introducing the bill in the first place, and what was the case made for it, and was there any opposition to it?
So at the time, the coalition of the government at the time was a coalition of the Labour Party and Fine Gael, the party that I represent. And there had been a small debate, is the only way I can describe it to you, because I think you know we're talking about a relatively small community and probably far less so in the Republic of Ireland than we would be in the United Kingdom. But there still was an absolute need to recognise that there were citizens, both young and indeed old, living a lie insofar as the state didn't recognise the true people that they were living the lives of. And so a lot of the people that had come to us to look for advocacy were already living the lives of their new assigned gender, but the state were just making it difficult. And actually, I think the thing that impassioned me so much is that we have an organisation in Ireland called Belong To, one of our LGBT groups. They look after children. And I met the parents of some of the children who were experiencing enormous difficulties because, and simple things that you and I would take for granted, if you're going through a passport, you know, control office, and you present yourself as one, but your passport says something, it was causing some of our younger people some major difficulties. But actually, at the same time, it was causing some of our adults to feel that they had been living in the shadow of their true self for so long, now that they had finally recognised, you know, and arrived at the space that they were happy and comfortable with, state still wasn't recognising that new person for the life that they were living. And to us, I think it felt like it was such a small thing in law to do, because it is distinctly different as to the medical journey that people have to go through for, you know, changes of gender if they do want to go through medical interventions. It felt like such a small thing to do to allow people, you know, in the 21st century to be able to live the life as the gender that they feel that they are, that they know to be true for themselves. And when you look at the legal changes that we had to do, first of all, it was just a self-declaration for an adult to go through the changes of the identification, you know, documents that they would have, whether it be, we've a card over here called a PPS card, which is a personal identifier card for people to have access with the state services. Then obviously you would have your passport. We changed it so that you could go back to your birth cert and get changed if that journey started for you, you know, much, much earlier than it did for some other people. So we just looked at, you know, the real life stories, albeit of a very small group of people that were coming to us telling us that these changes would make an enormous difference for the state recognising these people for who they truly were. And yeah, there was, like, I suppose, like, Ireland and Scotland are very similar. We have a lot of centrist politicians. We do have politicians on the left, and we have a very small grouping of what we would call politicians to the right of centre. Some of those conservative views did express, you know, change wasn't necessary, that it actually wasn't. They talked a lot about a theory of gender identity, whereas in actual fact it is a reality for the people who were living the experience. And so kind of, but the debate that we had was very, it was very respectful, which is not something that I've seen in other jurisdictions, and it's not something that we've a growing debate at the moment in Ireland, and it's not respectful. And so I sometimes look back when we went through that process of enacting the legislation in 2015, and then when I did the review, it nearly felt like it went under the radar. Now, there was thorough debates in the Parliament, and both in the Shannon and in the Oireachtas. We had to go through all of the stages that every other piece of legislation goes through. All of our media were watching, so it wasn't that we did it, you know, on a Sunday evening. You know, we did all of the things that we do with all of the other legislation, but there wasn't that divisive negative debate. And there was a real a humanitarian view that this was such a small thing in legislation, but such an enormous thing for the people whose lives that we were helping obviously be better. So.
No, that's great. And when you touched upon there about the state recognition, I did a back reading on this, and there was a few people saying that in regards to the amount of people coming forward and coming out, it did increase, but it was because they felt more protected and respected by the state, and that was incredibly important for them in regards to the equal marriage legislation and the gender recognition legislation. So that confirms what you're saying there. In regards to the diagnosis for gender dysphoria, the bill that we're looking at the moment would be removing that aspect of it and also removing the gender recognition panel. This, a note, has been done by yourselves, and I was just wondering how has that progressed? How has that been, the whole process, without it being connected to a medical diagnosis?
I think one of the things that the opposition, the people who opposed the bill at the time, were absolutely adamant about was that it needed to have a medical certificate to go along with it. So I couldn't just arrive tomorrow and say that I've been struggling, you know, and I want to identify as gender X. What I needed to do was to go through this very, what is in Ireland, and it may not be true of other jurisdictions, a very protracted, very long waiting lists. We have very small numbers of professionals in this area. In fact, we only have two in the country. And even though we have a small community, you know, of people, two certainly isn't enough, obviously, to address the issue. But what we were doing, and the department that gave rise to the legislation, had nothing to do with the provision of medical services or nothing to do with the allocation of a medical diagnosis. And so there are some people who are I'll say blessed insofar as that their journey from one gender to another isn't as traumatic as it would be for others, or isn't as medically intense as it would be for some, you know, for some to others. But this simply was to give legal recognition, not to help assist, you know, in getting up the queue of the medical interventions, if that's what you needed in any way, shape or form. You still had to do all of the things that you would have had to do beforehand, and that still is a dismay to lots of us in this country. But what this was just changing the legal process to make it easier for you. So to our mind, there was no need for an adult, so this was somebody over the age of 18, to have any recognition from any doctor to say, you know, you're grand, I can acknowledge that you need to change. You were an adult and you were entitled and allowed in this new law to make that decision for yourself. And that's why when we first introduced the legislation, it was easier for us to say if you weren't an adult, if you were 16 and 17, that you did still need that medical intervention. And it wasn't because the review isn't a better route to go with just the consent of parents, because I believe it actually is, and it would be a lot less cumbersome. It attempted to give solace to the people who were really railing against the idea of being able to self-determine in law and change your legal documentation. It gave them some connection and some protection, as they felt it was, that children wouldn't be able to do it. The argument was to do it willy-nilly, as if anybody does anything like this, you know, without an enormous journey of thought-provoking change and challenge. But to be, you know, on the balance of trying to be, you know, progressive, but also be recognising that there are some concerns there, we tried to do both. And so the 16 and 17-year-olds in the first legislation had to go through that medical certificate. It didn't work, and that's why the review was so easy to try and come to a new recognition, which is such a pity why it hasn't passed any progress since 2019. But the thought that an adult, as in anybody over the age of 18, would require a medical doctor to say that you are what you are when you know in your heart and soul and you've lived the life and are living and want to live the life that you want to live, we didn't feel that they needed to have anything to do with the doctor unless there was a medical intervention journey required, and that was a personal choice of the person.
That's really helpful, Regina. Thank you. Thanks.
Thank you. And can I go to Pam Duncan-Glancy, please?
Thank you, convener, and good afternoon, Senator. Thank you for joining us and for the information you've given us in advance. It's invaluable, and also the answer so far have been really helpful. I want to go kind of straight into one of the areas of contention around the bill, and I think you've kind of alluded earlier to it, but I'm really keen to hear from you as a legislator about how you navigated this. So you'll know that a lot of the contention around the bill as proposed is that it could negatively impact on women's ability to access single-sex spaces. And so I wondered what your response to that is. If you could tell us a little bit about how the legislation in Ireland has interacted with women's rights and their access to single-sex spaces. And then finally, if you could comment on whether or not you've seen any abuse of the self-declaration model for bad faith acting men at trying to use the self-declaration system to for bad faith, basically.
Thank you. Do you know, and you might find this very hard to believe given the debate that had previously happened in Scotland, and particularly the debate that started in the United Kingdom and still rages on, we didn't have that in 2015. I genuinely cannot explain to you why we didn't have it, because we did all of the pre-legislative scrutiny that was required, all of the advocacy bodies, both for people within the LGBT or trans community or the non-binary community, were all there, you know, living, breathing and praying that this got through. We didn't have a huge amount of negativity. We do have today, however, in light of we're changing a piece of employment law legislation in the next couple of weeks, and we're proposing to change one of the language in the Maternity Act of the bill. I think that the current language is around pregnant women, and we're proposing to change the language to pregnant people to be an all-encompassing terminology, the same way as you'd have chairperson as opposed to chairwoman, chairman, and nobody blinked an eye at it. And it is the debate in Ireland around those safe spaces for women, the fact that, you know, there's a real fear that's growing because a woman might be fearful of her safety from a trans man or a trans woman who might invade a space in Zara when I'm trying on a new frock. Whereas the debate is put distinctly separately that all women, and I don't mean this to be disrespectful to any of our male colleagues here today or my own colleagues, all women have safety issues with regard to male violence. And it's something that we talk about a lot. We talk about the domestic violence, we talk about coercive control. All of the changes that we've made to legislation in the last number of years are around the fact that male violence impacts society. And it doesn't just impact women. You know, it impacts men, it impacts children. And we all recognise that, and we do our best to obviously try and mitigate that. But the notion that women now have to fear a man dressing up as a woman, getting a gender identity certificate so that he can threaten me in a nurse, you know, in a dressing room, or if we ever did have single-sex toilets, I don't know if you have them in Scotland, but we certainly don't have them over here yet. To me, it's kind of fanciful when you recognise that in the Irish state, women have issues with regard to safety because of male violence. And I don't think a man who wants to be violent towards a woman needs to go to the extent of changing his certificate gender, you know, through a certificate so that he can get access to me in the dressing room of Zara or wherever it happens to be. I think it's a false misnomer. I genuinely think we have a debate that happened a number of months ago because we have a number of prisoners in Limerick prison in the southwest of our country who are in a female prison who identified as female after they had been arrested and charged. And to my mind, first of all, the law is that they can change their gender if that's what they want to do. But any prison warden or officer running an institution or a congregated setting has to mitigate against all risks. And if a patron of a prisoner, facility is a threat or a risk, regardless of their gender, then mitigating circumstances have to be put in place to protect all of the other prisoners. And you don't do that just because a male, identified as a female so that he could get access. If you think that that person is a risk to the other prisoners, well, then obviously you would expect the authorities to react and to provide safe, passage and daily activities for the other prisoners, regardless of the person's gender. And so again, to me, I think what we're trying to do is to reduce a very, very small argument or an example that happens to maybe impact 0.00% of society nearly, to conflate it with an argument that women have to be fearful of male violence. And I don't believe, and I think if we handle this correctly in the next couple of weeks, because this never came up in the first iteration of the law or the review of the legislation in 2019, I don't believe that women need to feel diminished in our gender identity just because there are other genders. I don't think my womanhood, my femininity, my role in society as a mother, I don't think any of those things are diminished by the fact that there are trans women, trans men, non-binary, intersex. I don't think any of those things diminish my role and my contribution to society. But I do think we need to have a proper conversation with some women who might think, yeah, hang on a second, like being a woman, being a female is a really important job in society and it shouldn't be downgraded, for want of a better way to put it. But it's not being downgraded. And so I think the way we have the conversation with women to absolutely assure them the fact that, generations ago, there were two genders, there were two sexes. There still are two sexes, but today I think we probably have about 9 genders. And that doesn't diminish any other gender within the gender identity set. I think that's a conversation that we need to have with people, and it doesn't, particularly women, it doesn't make them more at risk or less at risk than they are today. But it certainly doesn't protect them by saying that, a trans female can't access the same spaces as other women. If we really believe today that men were going to go to the extent dressing up as women and changing their gender to get access to be violent towards other women, but that I think we have an even far greater problem than the male violence that we have currently in all of our countries and jurisdictions.
Thank you for that, Senator. That was really clear. Can I just ask one final question on a similar related note, and that's on data collection. Can you tell us about the impact on data collection of the legislation that you've brought in, and in particular data on the representation of women on boards or anywhere else for that matter?
Again, it probably had very little impact. And apologies, I tend to go on, so please interrupt me if I'm rabbiting on for too long. The data that we collect, obviously, from the GRO, which is our General Registrations Office, which handles births, deaths, marriages, all of the changes of certificates, it's a really small number of people that have presented every year for the last 7 years to change their recognition. Can I ask you, if you're asking me, have we now got trans women, trans men, non-binary people on any board in the country that isn't an advocacy group for LGBTI rights? The answer, unfortunately, would be no. And so we have very, very few people, even in the workplace. It's a really, really tiny community of people that actually, even though they may have their certificates, actually come to work in the environment. So whilst, I think we had a number of years where we were all very compassionate. Around the same time as the gender recognition, we had marriage equality, and that was a huge change in the psyche of Irish people, given that we were historically very, very Catholic and very, very conservative for many years. There was a kind of a euphoria of a recognition that we finally actually managed to get our act together and to be normal human beings and just accept people you know, and to apply the same dignity that we would expect ourselves to be treated by others to others. And there was all of that love feeling, you know, going around in the country. So there was very, very little negativity. Yeah, there was the people who didn't like it, but even their tones were framed in a kind of a respectful way. We have no data other than the organisations, as I said to you, are belong to. We have an organisation called Tenny, which is our trans rights advocacy group. We have a Jigsaw, which is a mental health advocacy group for young people going through, you know, changes and their journey of their sexuality. All of those people would have very diverse boards and chairs. But outside of that, I'm sad to say that no, there isn't really an awful lot. And so even if we did have a data collection mechanism, there isn't really an awful lot of data to collect.
Thank you. And I'm sorry to hear that's the situation, but thank you for sharing it. I guess the other kind of part to my question was about has the self-identification, a move to self-identification, has that affected data about women?
In what way? Sorry now.
So it's been put to the committee that if we move to a self-declaration model and don't collect data on both sex and gender, that we could not necessarily have the information that we might need to determine whether or not we're making progress in certain areas of women's equality. And I'd just be keen to know if that's something that you considered. And I appreciate that some of these questions appear to be coming slightly left field, as you've described, because of the experience you had in 2015. But I'm just really keen to understand how much of that was explored or what you're seeing now.
No, can we ask anything that you want to ask? There's no problem. It wasn't. And again, so when it was the General Register's Office, the legislation that we were changing, so it's all around legal documentation. And so up until that point, on your legal documentation, you could only be male or female. And so these changes allowed you to be trans male, trans female. It allowed you to be non-binary. It allowed you to change your gender as opposed to obviously distinctly changing your sex. But in a lot of the legal documentation, it's the same thing. And so if I was born a female, I was allowed to go back and change my birth certificate to say that I was born a male. And so it effectively changed my sex as opposed to changing or introducing a new gender as distinctly separate as to the sex that I was born. The only change, and this is kind of embarrassing, the only change to data collection that we did was that this year we had a census. It was a number of years late because of COVID, but this year we had a census. For the first time ever on our census collection form, you were allowed to be either male, female, or neither of the above. And there was a whole debate in Ireland, is that why can't you just ask the questions? Because there's nine genders. Just put the nine genders in. Stop trying to be afraid of the fact that there are other genders. Anyway, it was too late. And it was taken up, it was a small debate and not a negative debate or anything, but just a kind of it was an irksome thing. Given that we have recognised genders, just bloody well use them. Like, stop being afraid to not use something that's legally recognised. There was an agreement that it was too late. The census forms had already gone out to our 4 million homes or whatever. We'd make sure we did it right in 5 years' time. But that's the only time that we have changed the collection of data in a census to try and capture somebody that may not see themselves as female or male, but we lost the opportunity for trying to capture what they do recognise themselves as. So the only way we have of knowing is the person that does actually come, go through the Gender Recognition Act and actually change their certificate.
Thank you.
Thank you. And Rachel Hamilton, please.
Good afternoon, Senator Doherty. Can I just ask you what you meant in your opening statement by that there's attempts to repeal the Act and we'll have a summer of discontent?
So, hi Rachel. Because we're proposing to change this employment legislation in the next number of weeks, one of the amendments from government is to change the terminology of pregnant women, and it's around maternity leave rights, to change it to pregnant people. There have been a number of organisations that have developed in the last number of weeks. A number of women have come together around the idea that, first of all, you won't disrespect women and you won't diminish my role in society by bunching me into pregnant people. The whole debate around people can't get pregnant, only women can get pregnant, that's the narrative that has developed over the last number of weeks. And the response to date so far is that, first of all, we're not diminishing the role of women in society. What we're doing is recognising that there are other genders in society who can absolutely get pregnant. And that's for, we're recognising the fact that there are more than one gender that can get pregnant, hence calling, you know, the catch-all term of pregnant people, but also to extend the legislative services and rights from time off work and for social welfare payments and stuff like that to pregnant people as opposed to just pregnant women. We have non-binary people presenting having babies. They're excluded from the legislation and from the state supports at the moment because they're not listed. And the pregnant people terminology was decided by our Attorney General as a catch-all phrase because it's been used before when services have been to be for men and women, not just men or women. And so I think where the conversation and the debate is going, Rachel, now is that instead of saying pregnant people, I think it would be easier for us to define the list of people who can become pregnant and name them all. So therefore not diminishing my role as a woman giving birth to my children and not trying to, you know, what's the word that was used a number of weeks ago, to dilute our contribution.
I suppose just to interrupt you there, you did offer us to do that. It's really interesting you're saying that because it seems as though you've regretted that wording within the census, because that's something that we've been, you know, talking about very much. And I just wondered how do you think the different terms used in data collection impact on the policy development, for example, in health and criminal justice?
I think it impacts hugely. Now, I say this to you, I'm speaking to you today, even though I'm a public representative in a personal capacity, I'm not representing any policy from any particular department. The review of the Gender Recognition Act was my policy when I was in the Department of Social Welfare. I don't believe it's current minister's policy. But I absolutely believe that if you don't recognise and capture in data sets the identities of the people that we're talking about, then you certainly are not going to devise good policy and services for those people. And so when we use catch-all terms so as not to offend and for it to be all-encompassing, I sometimes think then you dilute the fact that there are distinct different genders other than male and female. And if we accept that there are and that it's not a theory as would be espoused by some people, well, then just recognise that they are and name them and collate the data and look at the people that you're serving and then look at the services that they need for those particular genders, if they're living different and distinctly separate lives to other genders, if their experiences are different. And so I think it's a real shame that we didn't capture it in this year's census, because we only do one every 5 years. So, but it'll absolutely be the next time it'll include all of the genders so that we can capture where they are in the country, who they are, what age they are. You know, we don't have any of that data.
Okay, I've got two more questions. I noted that within your Gender Recognition Act, there was a reporting process, and that was for the Minister for Social Protection to prepare a report on the performance of his or her function under the Act in the immediately preceding year. I haven't had time, unfortunately, to look at that, but is that something that's laid every year? And what did that find? Did that find that there were things you could have done better that that you could recommend this Parliament to be doing, and things that, for example, I want to ask you about prison. So I'll probably just do that just now, because I'm sort of looking at the unintended consequences of some of the Act. I just wondered, really, in terms of the analysis that you did, we know that not to undermine the number of women who are in prison because of domestic abuse and they weren't able to prove defence. But in Ireland, the cases that you have referred to with males with GRCs being sent to prison, did you do any analysis prior to or during the evidence sessions of the bill to work out the impact of males with GRCs being housed in female prisons?
So what we did do at the time was look at other jurisdictions that had passed similar legislation to us and the lived experience in that country. And again, probably because we were one of one of the first, and you're nearly one of the first countries to introduce this kind of legislation. There wasn't an awful lot to look at, but we did do some work. The prison thing, the shared dressing room spaces, and the school toilet were the three things that came up in the jurisdictions that we looked at. But again, the instances were so minute, and that when you balanced it against the fact that, like, do we really believe that there was first of all, if you can hold in your mind that the passing of the legislation is a good thing for the people that need it, to need the legal recognition to live their lives, and if you balance it against a fear of not doing it because somebody might declare themselves as a female to get access to females.
Sorry, Senator Doherty, in your answer, I think it was to Karen Adams' question, or in your opening statement, you did state that that it was a great piece of legislation, it was for a very tiny number of people. But now you're arguing that the opposite, that the tiny number of people that may be affected, for example, in a prison setting, so it's not like for like in terms of the argument that you're making.
So I don't think I am, so maybe I'm not being clear, so apologies. So to our mind, to change the legislation to have the massive positive impact on a very small community's life was a very good thing for us to do. If we could help those people in that community, whatever of the gender that they were, outside of male and female, to live a fulfilled life recognised by the state, it was a good thing to do. What I'm suggesting to you is that some of the concerns that were raised at the time was those spaces, female-only spaces. And so prisons is one that's used a lot. Dressing rooms are used, particularly around our children. The example of toilets in secondary schools or primary schools are used. And when we balanced and looked at other jurisdictions, had those problems or issues materialised, there were very, very little evidence to say that they had. Having said that, in our own country, we have two people currently in Limerick prison who were born genetically male, who have self-identified as female, and they are now in female confinement in a women's only prison in Limerick. And the argument is that they only did what they were doing to get access to women. And my response back to people was that if any prison warden feels that there is a potential risk by any member, whether it's a shared prison, a male-only or a female-only prison, regardless of the person's, whether it's self-identified or not, it's up to the prison warden to make sure that all of his patrons are safe. And so I don't know the reasons behind the journey that the two people who are in the prison in Limerick, you know, have taken. But I do know there's a real suspicion that they're not really, you know, the gender that they've assigned themselves today, that they only did what they did to get into a female prison. I think that's something that the state obviously needs to be very careful of and very conscious of. But absolutely, if there are any other risks outside of the gender that presents for the patron body of a prison, it's up to the prison warden to make sure that he looks after the safety and the welfare of all of his prisoners, you know, regardless of how they identify gender-wise, if that makes sense.
Thanks.
Okay, thank you very much. And can we now go to Maggie Chapman, please?
Good afternoon, Senator. Thank you very much for joining us today, and thank you for the evidence and your answers so far. I'm interested in exploring along similar lines, I suppose, to some of Pam's and Rachel's questions about unintended consequences and lessons learned. And I suppose one of the things that we've heard evidence from or people's concerns around are the misaligned other public services, particularly, I suppose, health. Rachel was talking about prison, but I suppose questions around health. In the Irish experience, have there been any instances of trans women or trans men who have not been able to access the health care they provide because of or gender conflicts on health records that you are aware of?
So unfortunately, Maggie, in Ireland, we have a very, very long waiting list with regard to access to the two professionals that are available in Ireland to people who are trans to try and get access to medical services that they would like to, you know, incorporate into their life to actually fully change their journey from one gender to another. We've, over the last number of years, actually, we've a scheme in Ireland called the National Treatment Purchase Fund, whereby if you can't get access to public health in Ireland, this fund is available for you to buy access to the health. So services, either in the private sector or elsewhere. We don't care for trans people in Ireland, and so we have been using the NHS for the last number of years, and sending sometimes, in some instances, children under the age of 18, in some instances adults over the age of 18, over to the NHS so that they can access the services in the United Kingdom. And so for us, I think it was important, and there's an awful lot of work that needs to be done to improve those medical services in Ireland, and that's absolutely no doubt. But if we had waited and aligned the legal recognition with the medical access, which isn't the journey for everybody, we wouldn't be passing the Gender Recognition Act for probably centuries. The change in health services is so slow in this regard in Ireland. And so that's why we kept them distinctly different and separate. So the legal recognition through documentation and access to services arising from that documentation was a relatively simple piece of legislation. To change and improve and enhance the medical access is another day's work for the Department of Health. And whilst the same advocacy groups obviously were advocating for both, it's a kind of a two-speed progress. So you asked me about regrets with regard to the original legislation. Yeah. The regret that we had that I would have attempted to resolve with the reviewed legislation was that the initial enactment for 16 and 17-year-olds in this country, because it was aligned by the medical certification requirement, made it absolutely so uncumbersome or so unattainable as to make that piece of legislation redundant because it wasn't actually workable. And when we looked at the review and made the recommendations to get rid of that two-step process and to have the second process step being consent of both parents, you know, either the both parents were supportive of the child's journey to changing gender, or they weren't, and then what we would do is make support services available to them, mediation services, just support, I won't call it counselling, but you know what I mean, anything that was required to help a family unit support the child in whatever journey that child was undergoing at the moment.
Thanks. That's really helpful. And I mean, we have some of the same issues of waiting times for accessing gender identity clinics that we have, and whether that is a medical and surgical routes or in some cases others as well. I suppose there's an issue of healthcare provision beyond that which is directly related to gender reassignment. And one of the questions put to us as a committee has been, well, how can we guarantee, how can we ensure that trans men will still be on the right registers for cervical screening, for those kinds of tests, and trans women will still be on the right lists for prostate tests and that kind of thing. Do you have any are there experiences or any processes that we can learn from you around making sure that we don't allow trans people to fall through a health gap that actually has that isn't about the medical intervention for their reassignment?
Again, Maggie, I'm embarrassed to say that we don't have that data. And so the opportunity to capture that data so that we could provide better services was in the CSO survey that we did only back in April of this year. We didn't capture it. What we've captured is your male, female, or other, which is absolutely worthless to anybody. And so we've a guarantee that we will capture it again in the next census. And again, so the only, and this is the two-edged sword, the only database, for want of a better word, that we have is in the GRO, so that if Regina Doherty presented to change, you know, my identity and my gender tomorrow to Reginald Doherty, that data would be collected within the GRO. But because of data protection and the GDPR legislation that we've all got from the European Union, that data can't be shared with anybody. So even if we could, you know, delve into that data to say, actually, there are 50 women in Dublin that changed their gender to men, let's make sure we capture them for cervical screening or for breast check or whatever it happens to be, we don't have the ability to access that right now. And so I would very much hope that in the next census that we will be able to capture all of the data and therefore be able to mine it to provide the better services that we need to for our people.
Okay, no, thank you. That's helpful. I think These are some of the questions that we are trying to grapple with, and learning what not to do is I think as important as learning what to do. And another question, just so we can learn from your experiences around the criminal offence and its relationship to revoking a GRC. Are you aware of any instance where somebody has revoked their GRC, whether there's been any hint of criminality in their initial self-declaration, or hasn't occurred in the Irish example?
Again, I'm not sure I'd be able to answer that question on the basis that the only database that we would have of people who have changed their identity is held at the GRO, and it isn't shared with anybody for any other purposes other than the report that's laid before the Houses of the Oireachtas at the end of every year. And literally, Maggie, what that report does is it tells you that under the Gender Recognition Act of 2015, 14 people changed their identity this year, seven female to male, or seven female, two to non, but you know, it doesn't actually tell you anything other than the numbers and that the Act is actually working. Insofar as that it's accessible, which is, in hindsight, is a real shame. And if we ever do get to do the review, there are other things that need to be done. And actually, there's a long list of things to be done with regard to language and terminology that we use all across the public service and the civil service, but also the collation of data so as to inform future policy, and not just healthcare policy. But as you say, you know, coming from a country that doesn't even have a register of domestic violence in Ireland, we've a long way to go with a lot of our data to learn. And I think this is definitely something that should be collated and then act upon for the people who have changed their identities. But as I said, the only report that we get every year is the numbers and what they changed from and to.
Thank you. No, that's fine. You mentioned there that there were things that you would change around language. As part of the review, you would have a discussion around language. Can you elaborate? Are you in a position to elaborate on that for us?
Yeah, so one of the things I wanted to do, because the review and the drafting of legislation was all around putting a system of gender recognition for children involving parental consent, process just to be an administrative process, have the third party support there for the family and the kids. That was the most important part of the changes of legislation that I felt that we could do relatively quickly. But the review group, it recommended loads of other things around the promoting the use and the acceptance of correct pronouns. It's something that my children take for absolute granted. Anybody in their teens or their 20s on any of their social media bios or even on their CVs these days, you know, have she, her. It's just a given, you know. My own child, the youngest, she's 15. She corrects me when, you know, I'm talking about some of her friends and I call, you know, somebody a her or a him because that's the sex that they were born in. She corrects me and puts her eyes up to heaven. It's something that you just take for granted. It's absolutely something that's completely alien to the civil and the public service. And so when you look at all of our legislation, it only refers to men or women. When you look at all of the services and the public system documents for anything you can access through the social protection system, through the welfare system, through the health system, it only ever relates to men or women. And so what I asked to happen that year, and again it hasn't, was for all of our departments to go away and say, show me what you can change, show me how you can improve the forms that people have to access by acknowledging and accepting that there are other genders other than men and female. All of that stuff could have been done without legislation. But unfortunately, as I said to you, the government didn't get re-elected in January of 2020, and we are where we are.
Okay, no. Thanks, Regina. That's really, really helpful. Thank you, Joe. I'll leave it there.
Thanks, Maggie. If we could now go to Fulton McGregor, please.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good afternoon, Senator. I've really enjoyed the session so far. I want to ask about some specific provisions that are in the bill that we're looking at. And I'll start with firstly, to live in the acquired gender for 3 months and the 3 month reflection period. Now, I'm aware that the Irish Act didn't include these time periods. What I want to understand though is, was there any discussion around time periods either before or after, and where did those discussions lead to, or was it never even on the table?
We felt at the time, particularly for adults, as anybody over 18, the evidence that was being presented to us is that nobody woke up on a Tuesday and decided that they weren't going to change their gender. There unfortunately usually is a very long, protracted, difficult journey to first of all self, you know, accept and recognise first of all, but then to determine, you know, how you would tell your family or, you know, all of that journey. And even for the smoothest of journey, for the luckiest of peoples, that it is smooth, because for most people, obviously, it's not, takes years. And so I think we felt at the time that if somebody came to the state over the age of 18 and wanted to change their gender, it wasn't for us to make sure that they had to dance a particular dance before that they would get the legal entitlement that we were putting in the legislation. And so because it was administrative, and I won't say effectively only a legal document, but because there was no other parallel process to go through with it, it literally was only changing a legal document. And so we were adamant that it was going to be as easy as it needed to be for people to change them. But also, if the reverse became apparent to a person insofar as that they made a mistake or that their journey, you know, of recognition wasn't complete quite yet, they could either reverse it or change it as relatively easily as they did in the first place. Where we got into different opinions was when we started talking about people under the age of 18. And so that's why initially we felt that if we tied it to the medical certificate, so therefore we would have some other professional to be able to say, yes, this 16-year-old has gone through a journey and is, you know, reliably identifying now as a different gender than the gender that they were born with. And that doctor gave us, you know, the okay, then the gender could proceed. But we know that that just wasn't physically possible because the waiting times for, you know, gender identity and acknowledgement or acceptance from the doctors were so protracted and the waiting lists were so long, it nearly made that part of the legislation useless. And that's why when we reviewed it, we removed the medical part of it and inserted the parental consent. We had long discussions around whether we needed both parents or just one parent. And I have to be honest with you. So the advocacy groups wanted just one parent because obviously they felt a child just needed one advocate. And in a lot of cases that they have seen, and this is a reality, so it's not, and I don't doubt their reality for a second. In a lot of cases, you'll have a child presenting to change gender and you'll have a very supportive one parent and a very unaccepting other parent. And to my mind, whilst that might be true, I felt that it was easier for us to try and have mediation and support services available for the entire family. Ultimately, I believe we all love our children. You might find it difficult to accept something that they're presenting to you, but we all love and want what's best for our children. And instead of going down the one parent consent route, we were planning on confining it to the two persons or two parents consent route, but giving them as much support and cooperation to help them on that acceptance journey, if I don't know what the proper language is, but to help them support their child in their child's journey of gender identity recognition. And so the Act would have been changed and maybe potentially still will be to introduce the third party support, the counselling, the mediation if one parent disagreed with the other to try and bridge the gap, just to support the family unit as opposed to making legislation that could potentially divide them. And so that's the route we took, as opposed to putting in time, weeks or months before anything could change legally. That's what we decided to do.
Okay, thanks for explaining that, Senator. And I do think that my colleague Pam Gosselaar is going to ask a wee bit more about the 16 to 18 year partial. But in terms of not having any time period either before or afterwards, and I know from what you've said to colleagues, there is an issue with data collection in Ireland, and I think you've explained that well. But is there any sort of anecdotal evidence that this has been a difficulty, or is there anything that you've been able to pick up over the last, is that 7 years the bill's been in, that not having either a period, you know, before or a reflection period, that has it been something that's been called for example?
No. So again, first of all, I suppose, and it is anecdotal based on their stories of the people that they represent experiences, our advocacy groups are the people that I would be continuously in contact with. they've just launched an amalgamated campaign for transgender equality in the last number of weeks because of the rise of discourse in Ireland around some of the fears that you would have expected to have been raised back in 2015, but genuinely weren't. And so the only thing I can tell you is that since the enactment of the legislation, adults have found it incredibly easy to use. And whilst we have had a number of reversals, they've been absolutely maybe less than 1% of the people who've changed their identity since 2015. The one thing that advocacy groups and parents would have told us is for those under the ages of 18, it simply hasn't worked. And simply still isn't working because the law still stands obviously as it was enacted in 2015. And so it's very cumbersome. The weight is still there. And in actual fact, what you're seeing is that those young adults who would have been able to change their gender under the age of 18 are literally now having to wait until the day after their 18th birthday and then they can apply.
OK. Yeah, thanks very much for that. Another bit I want to ask about is a provision in the bill to be ordinarily resident in Scotland. And we've heard some concerns that that might lead to people coming from other parts of the UK, England, Wales, or Northern Ireland to seek a GRC. And I know that you've got something similar, although there's possible, they're possibly looking to expand it, but I know there's something similar in Ireland. Has that been a concern? You're very similar to ourselves, and you share a border with one other country, so people travelling north to south in your case rather than south to north. But has that been something that has happened? Is that a concern?
Yeah, and you know what? It's probably easier for us than it might be for you, because in the Republic, obviously, we only have one legal jurisdiction, whilst we do share the island of Ireland with another legal jurisdiction. Their general registration office is your general registration office, and mine is distinctly different. And so the legislation that we passed can only change Irish certs. So it could only change an Irish birth cert, an Irish marriage cert, an Irish passport. Somebody from the north of Ireland, unless they had an Irish passport, even then, we wouldn't have the ability to change their birth cert because it would have been given by the General Registration Office of the United Kingdom or Northern Ireland or Scotland or Wales, if you have distinct different ones. And so our legislation literally only pertains to Irish documentation. So we can only change an Irish birth cert, an Irish passport, an Irish driving licence, an Irish marriage licence. We can change your PPS number that you use with the revenue services from being a he to a she. So it literally is, when we say ordinarily resident, if you were living here tomorrow, you wouldn't be able to apply for RG or A unless you are an Irish citizen. And even then it would be difficult because your probably birth cert is Scottish. So it literally can only change Irish legal documents. It can't change anything else.
Yeah, thanks for that, and thanks for clarifying that. And perhaps not as quite a match-up as I first thought. And I'll take that one on the chin. Thanks.
Thank you, Fulton. And Pam Goswell, please.
Thank you, Convener, and good afternoon, Senator Doherty. There's quite a lot being covered already, but I'll try and see that go for an area that's not been covered and go back to some of the areas just to seek a little bit more clarity. One of the areas I want to touch on is my colleague Rachel spoke about data collection in relation to health and justice. I just want to talk a little bit about the data collection on the basis of gender as opposed to sex and potential impact that will have on equality measures such as gender pay gaps. And did the introduction of any self-ID policy in Ireland result with similar concerns? And do you share these concerns at all as well? And are you aware of the policy in Ireland having effect on any other data collection policies? But obviously, I know you've covered a little bit about justice and health when my colleague asked, but just more about the gender pay gap, because we have heard this from some of the witnesses that have come forward to talk about that. So just a little bit about your concerns and your thoughts on how you tackled this area.
Again, embarrassingly so, none of these things were identified as issues around the time of the enactment of the legislation. And so because of the way the legislation was drafted, There is no data collection other than in the General Register's office, I would present and change my gender and all of my legal documents would go from being a she to whatever I would identify as. And so insofar as collecting data to feed into justice legislation, employment legislation, it's not there. And so whilst I did say to you, we are in the process of changing employment law, it's not, we're changing the terminology to reflect the reality of that there are more than one gender. But in actual fact, we couldn't tell you how many pregnant people there could be in Ireland, because what we don't know is how many trans women there are, trans men there are, how many non-binary people there are, how many intersex people. We haven't collected that data. And so therefore, that's to me and to my mind, even speaking to you here today, it's a glaring gap in policy formation, because you're really, you're enacting policy to be all encompassing without knowing how many people you're actually enacting the policy for. And we certainly are, Pam alluded to it earlier on, that we have no knowledge for the likes of our public services, such as prostate check, breast check, cervical check. None of those would include any of our new gendered registered people. And that's a glaring omission. So learn by our mistakes. I'm not even sure we realised it was a mistake until you've told me here today, which is for show. But
thank you for that, Senator Doherty, for being so honest about that, because that's an area that obviously, looking at the bill now, we've got a very good opportunity to look at these kind of areas. Just going back to talking a little bit about what my colleague Pam Duncan-Glancy spoke about, some of the groups and the work you've done on single-sex spaces and services. I just wanted to touch on Women of Faith. You've probably been following our committee that, people have raised this personally with me, and obviously it's been brought up in the committee as well. How did you go about addressing that? That did you have other groups of religion, women of faith, whether they were, accessing services or single-sex spaces? That did that come across any of the work you were doing in your 2015 Act?
Again, to be very honest with you, we had very little acrimony. We did have concerns that were expressed, but they were actually expressed to us in relatively muted tones, if I'm to be really honest with you. And yes, we still have some very conservative people. We have an enormous faith base, particularly Catholic faith, and a growing Muslim faith base in Ireland, that would have very distinct and opposing views to this. The way we tried to handle it at the time was that, first of all, every human being deserves to live with dignity. And for me, and no life is simple, so I don't say this lightly. For me, I was born female. I am now an adult female woman. I have four beautiful children. I happen to be very happy in my own boots. For lots of people, they don't get to be that content. And so for us as a state, I felt and we feel that it was our responsibility to make that transitionary journey for people who've already walked a difficult path through their own, self-determination and acknowledgement and journey to get to where they are now. Make that legal process as easy, and as dignified as possible. And again, to reassure people that just because there were different genders didn't lessen the genders that we've known for generations or for time immemorial. And so for faith-based people, the fact that the legislation changed doesn't change their faith or their beliefs. And they don't ever have to, and I don't mean this sarcastically, they don't ever have to change, their faith or allow that in their own life, their own family, if that's what they choose. But as a nation and as a state, we have to be here to serve all of our people and to recognise that there was a small community of Irish people that were not best served by us denying them the life that they absolutely wanted to live in the gender that they believe and recognise themselves to be. And so we just try to handle it in that way. There's no threat to my gender identity from realising that there are other genders.
Thank you for that, Senator Doherty. Just on that obviously you're absolutely right. Everybody has a right, whether you're a trans person or whether you whatever religious background you come from. However, how can you impose upon people that have certain religious, not beliefs, but it is their religion, especially women going to a doctor? I think you've probably heard my example. How does that practically work? And obviously, it's not come up in Ireland yet, I hear from you, but is it something that when you're looking at the gender equality stuff that you would look at some of this stuff as well, maybe? Because obviously, we'll be looking at this as well, and we are hearing from witnesses, and we need to make sure that we have that fair playing field for everybody to be, you know, access those services and those spaces as well.
So, excuse me, but I'm not aware of your example. So maybe if you could just tell me the example that you mean, and then I can see if it has happened in Ireland and if we have, how we've responded or reacted to it.
I think
the woman presenting.
Sorry. I mean, we've talked about a little bit with examples when people use changing spaces. You've got that. You're aware of that. The other example is, and, you know, I watch how I use my wording here, that if a woman of colour from Indian or Muslim goes to a doctor, and normally they would see that the doctor there, they would ask for maybe a smear test or something like that and ask for a female doctor. Now, if they're in there and it was a trans person into a female, trans female, and that person wouldn't know, and it's not up to that trans person to tell that person who they are, because that's their right, which is understandable, you know, that they don't have to say, but it would break the religion of that female if that female was to find out later on that that doctor, and she didn't have an opportunity to know anything, because that trans person has the right to privacy, but also that person of religion and belief has the right to religion as well. So how do we see, you know, and it'd be good if you could give, you know, some kind of answer to this, but how do we see that a happy medium, that we respect both sides and we come out with a balanced view that can help that service be delivered?
Yeah. So, apologies, I should have known what you were asking me, so I'm sorry I didn't. I actually don't see this because maybe I'm in the privileged position of being a woman as opposed to being a minority gender. If we are to recognise that there are currently now 7 genders, or maybe even 9, if I'm not as up to date as some of my younger people are, let's just take the 7 that we know we legally recognise in Ireland. If we legally recognise 7 genders, well, then I don't think I should have any problem telling you I'm a trans man, trans woman, non-binary, intersex, you know, non-gender. If I am that gender, like, I don't have any problem with you asking me my gender, I tell you I'm a woman. If the lads sitting around beside you, I'm quite sure that they wouldn't have any problem. So therefore, if you were a trans woman or a trans man or an intersex, you know, why would you feel, I don't know what the word is, marginalised or put upon by having to say what you are? Because to my mind, in the scenario that you've just described, each person has to be respected and treated with dignity. And the person that has religious beliefs has a right to be treated by a woman if she wants to be treated by a woman. If she goes in and she picks a non-binary doctor, well, then she might find it more difficult to find one. But you know what I mean? I'm not being facetious. I think there's nothing wrong with asking to be treated by a female woman doctor, as you know, because there distinctly is something different between a woman and a trans woman. And that brings me back to the debate we're having in Ireland right now. Like, maybe we shouldn't be using the word pregnant people. We should be using the word, you know, pregnant woman, pregnant trans male, pregnant non-binary person, pregnant intersex person. It's not, okay, it might seem clunky, but it is the reality of what actually exists in life at the moment. And if you are a trans man, yes, of course you can have a baby because you were born a female sex. And if you haven't had any, you know, medical interventions to remove those parts of your body, then of course you can have a baby, but you're distinctly different to a woman. So,
no,
vice versa is the same. If you're a trans woman, then you were born physically a man, and I think any woman presenting to a doctor in that scenario has a right to know.
Thank you very much, Senator Doherty. I just want one last thing, just in the back of my colleague Fulton speaking about age, if you can elaborate a little bit more on that. Obviously, you know that we're looking at changing from the GRSE 18 to 16-year-old. And you've heard from many committees that where people are for and some are against the fact that, you know, at 16, 17, you can go ahead and get married, you can vote. But on the other hand, people have concerns that they don't feel that these people are adults yet to make those decisions, and the fact that you can't basically go ahead and get credit cards, certain things that you can't happen in your life. What's your kind of balance on that, that looking at if it went down to 16? Because I know that your age cohort requires both parental consent and medical evidence in order to be granted the court order that is required. So just a little bit on that, touching on that.
So we're probably not as progressive as Scotland is, because you can't get married, drink, get a driving licence, any of those things in Ireland until you're 18. So it was easy for us to keep the cut-off point of being an adult. Sorry, you can't vote either in Ireland. You don't become an adult until you're 18. And when you become 18, then you're making your own choices. Below that, the original legislation as it stands today does need the medical certificate, which is cumbersome to get. The hope was to change it so that you would just have parental consent. And again, it was in an environment where you would hope that both parents were, you know, agreeable, and because they've seen the life that their child has lived and are accepting and supportive of it. And in those cases where there was a disagreement between parents, then obviously to put in the support mechanisms, the family support, the mediation, the counselling services, anything that would help them make that decision easier for them. Now, they may not make the decision, and you might, but we were absolutely concentrated on the fact that you needed both parents, and we would help both parents to arrive on the same page. But if they didn't, then you respected the fact that we still needed both parents. I'm mindful, I have four children. The youngest is 15, the eldest is 22. So I've done that 16 and 17 year old a couple of times already. They know absolutely everything. And yet we all know that when we stop being 16 and 17, we realise just how little we did really know. And so it's a very precious space in a person's life. You do want to help, but you also need to make sure that everybody is reassured that the state is doing the right thing by young adults. I hope we got the balance, even though we haven't changed it yet. I hope we were getting the balance right between the parental consent, both parents, parents consenting, and the supports for the family.
Thank you very much, Senator Doherty. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm mindful of time, but Maggie Chapman would like to come back in for another question, if that's okay. Maggie.
Thanks very much, and thank you for your time, Regina. I really appreciate it. Just very quickly, one of the proposals in the reform that we're looking at is to include the option for a person of interest, so a person who is associated with the person who is applying for a gender recognition certificate, to be able to either to have a say in that whether that person is a spouse or another close family member. And I just wondered whether the Irish legislation, whether you considered it at the time in 2015, whether you'd have some kind of relationship other than parents for 16 and 17 year olds. Was there any other capacity for anybody else to have a say around whether somebody should or should not be granted a gender recognition certificate?
So, Maggie, we had a long debate during the review, much longer than I thought it would take. And the reason we did was because we did consider putting an advocate in for the state. Mm-hmm. There was a belief by some people around the review board that some parents mightn't act in the best interest of a child. Excuse me, and so therefore we could have a scenario potentially where a child changed their gender, the parents were supportive of it, but not really knowing of the impact of it. And there was a view felt by some people at the table that we needed to have somebody from the state needed to be at the table. And so even though we were saying mum and dad needed to make the decision, that we needed mum and dad and, you know, the Minister for Justice, or I don't know, would you know what I mean? I have to be honest with you, I railed seriously against it, as did the advocacy groups. To my mind, the family unit is probably one of the most special relationships that exists. And the two people that think more of a child in 99.9% of the cases that I know of are mum and dad. And whilst the experience that we know doesn't mean that mum and dad are always equally accepting, they are certainly the people that love the child the most. And so we centred around, instead of having the state, we're like being a big brother, we had the state being the supportive mechanism of the mediation and the family support. And so what we envisaged, and we probably didn't have enough of them in the country to actually establish it, but we would have had to put money behind the policy when the law was passed. We would have had to set up in each county, obviously, those mediation family support units. Probably would have done it through TUSLA, our child and family agency that we have in Ireland. But they definitely needed to be seen as being helpful as opposed to being controlling.
Thanks, Regina, that's helpful. And what about for adults? Was there any discussion around a spouse having a say or a sibling or anything like that?
No, because again, the mindful was is that once you reach adulthood, you're making your own decisions. And obviously, if you were like, there was a discussion around particularly married people that obviously I independently making a decision has a massive impact on my family. If I was making that decision, I was going to do it anyway. And so we didn't feel like we could hinder, because again, you know, for me to give the power, for want of a better way to put it, over me being able to live my true life to somebody else who mightn't be happy about the changes to their life by me living my true life, we felt it was unfair. So there certainly was discussions about it at the time. But again, we felt, as with all legislation, an adult, you know, Irish person is an adult Irish person, and they get the full extent of the law as an independent adult themselves. And that's where we ended up with.
Thanks, Regina. That's really helpful and really clear. Much appreciated.
Thanks very much. I think we could go on, Regina, for the rest of the afternoon, but I know your diary is pressing, and I think we have to get back into the chamber too. So huge thank you for taking the time and giving us your time. So that concludes the public part of our meeting, and we'll move into private session. Thanks very much.